has also, like I said, been a close friend and support, especially when I started WeCan, which is now run by somebody else. Mohana is an advocate practicing in the Bombay High Court and the City Civil Court since 1982. She's a partner of JMB Partners, a director and legal advisor at Ugam Solutions and Ugam Interactive Solutions and Avalon Consulting. Is it correct? I got this correct. She's also the proprietor of Mohana Nair Associates. Interestingly, while she is practicing as a lawyer, she did her MSc in electronics and has a diploma in financial management. That's why so much of the banking-related issues, I guess. More than anything else, we know Mohana for the wonderful work she does in lending her support and her time to public interest litigation. She also serves as an advisor to several corporates, banks, financial institutions, as well as builders. Her area of specialization include corporate and commercial law, legal advice, banking, insurance, intellectual property, dispute resolution, litigation, arbitration, IT law, and legal services, joint ventures, and other civil matters. She is also a member of the Notary Greater Mumbai, the Bombay Bar Association, the Intellectual Property Law Practitioners Association, and of the legal cell of the Bombay Chamber of Commerce. She is associated with Dignity Foundation and Times Foundation as part of her social commitment as well. She's worked in collaboration, of course, with Awas Foundation to support and strengthen local opposition to open cast mining in the biodiverse wildlife corridor of Sawantwadi near Sindhudurg. With these few words, I think we should start the proceedings.
It all started with Satyendra Dubey. Everybody was very, very concerned suddenly by what is happening. This young boy who had tried to bring out what was happening in his area of work had been threatened and killed. And suddenly the government and all the, like Sumera said, the IITs, IIMs definitely stood up for him. And so the government decided that this was the time that something should be done. So first this, and of course a PIL was filed with the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court urged the government to pass a law, put down some guidelines so that this kind of thing doesn't happen again. And in view of that, the government first decided that the Central Vigilance Commission would be authorized to look into all these things, where this was mainly for the bureaucrats and people in the government who were complaining against their own departments or their head of the departments. So it was set up for that the Central Vigilance Commission would look into their complaints and try to find some way out. But this was done in 2004, but nothing happened for many years. And then finally in 2010, the Public Interest Disclosure and Protection to Persons Making Disclosures Bill was framed. This was tabled in the Parliament, but then it was sent off before the committee set up by the Parliament, and then it was placed on the website for comments of people. There were a lot of comments from activists, from the civil society, bureaucrats. Everybody gave a lot of comments saying that this bill was not sufficient, it should be strengthened much more. So then the present whistleblowers bill was enacted, or rather it was drafted, and it was placed before the Lok Sabha, which just passed it without any comments whatsoever in 2011. Then for 2-3 years nothing happened again, it just remained there. Finally, just before this session of Parliament was closing, it was placed before the Rajya Sabha. There was, on the very last day this was passed, there was no time for making any comments. The opposition did try to say it should be strengthened, some things should be done, but they were told that, oh, we'll take care of it in ordinances, just let's pass it, today is the last day. So, earlier it was all the Lokpal Bill, Lokayukta, this bill didn't get much attention, so it was passed with no comments by the Rajya Sabha. It still has to be notified by the president's assent has to come, and then it has to be notified. And more than that, unless the rules are framed, the act cannot be enforced. So all the rules have to be framed, that has to be notified. And rules also have been set up in two different sections, because this act concerns with the central government, people working in the central government, as well as people working in different state governments. So each state government has been allowed to make their own rules to see how it will be enforced in their states, and the central government for their union and ministers and all those people. So this is how it has reached this stage, at least So for whatever it is worth, we have a bill which may be, when the next session of Parliament comes, it may become law, unless they decide to scrap it and start all over again. But at present, there seems to be some semblance of a bill, which I will talk about as we go further. So some of the positive features of the bill. Now, first of all, this bill does not really relate to some of the things which Sumaira was talking about activists having problems with mafia. This really concerns only the ministers, the cabinet ministers, the MPs and the bureaucrats, MLAs and the bureaucrats. It does not concern the private sector. It does not talk about corporates. So there is nothing in this bill by which you can complain about those sectors. It is only about the government. And secondly, it only talks about corruption, financial corruption. It does not talk about somebody doing something against the environment or against public health. It's only financial corruption and financial loss to the government which is addressed in this bill. But it still has some positive things. One is that the identity of the complainant to be concealed and known only to the competent authority. The competent authority is the person to whom you make your complaint. So only that person will know your identity. He will not reveal it to anybody else. Now, of course, the whole list of competent authorities have been mentioned in the bill. So if it is a cabinet minister or ministers of the union, it will be to the prime minister, and so on and so forth. But what happens, it's not the prime minister who's going to look at it himself. It's going to the office of the prime minister. So how much this identity of the person is going to be concealed is something we have to wait and watch. But the bill does provide for the concealment of the identity to be known only to the person to whom the complaint is addressed. And that is the competent authority for a specific body. Then public servants cannot refuse to provide. So once this complaint is filed before a competent authority, the competent authority has the right to ask the head of the department against whom the complaint has made for more information documents. And they cannot come back and say that, oh, this is protected against the Official Secrets Act and we can't give you the thing. That is not permitted under this act. But when I come to the negative aspects, I will explain how there are many other things which are protected. Since this is really related to a person working in a department, trying to give information about what is wrong in his own department, what is being done, which should be told to a competent authority. And when that complaint goes back to the head of the department or to his own department, there is a chance that he will be victimized. He will be not given promotions, he will be transferred, or there will be adverse remarks in his report. So to avoid that, there is a clause that victimization of the person who makes a complaint is not allowed, is not permitted. But what is victimization is not at all mentioned anywhere in the Act. It just says that victimization should be, he should be protected against victimization, and the competent authority, he can make a complaint to his competent authority and they will take action. They will ensure that he is not victimized. But how they will ensure, none of those things have been set down. Then there are many penalties provided. One, if there is incorrect information given by the public authority, like when the competent authority will ask the head of the department, please give me information, more information. This person who comes may have enough information for the competent authority to feel, yes, something is wrong, let me inquire into it. But then he is entitled to ask the head of the department, and the head of the department in turn will ask the people working under him, please provide the competent authority with the required information documents. Now, if they don't want things to come out, they will give false information, or they'll refuse to give information, or give documents which are forged, misleading. So there is a penalty provided for that. Similarly, there are penalties provided if somebody reveals the identity of the complainant. Because that is what we are trying to protect in the whistleblowers bill, that the identity of the complainant should not be revealed to anyone except to the competent authority, because then he cannot be victimized, he cannot be murdered, threatened, anything. Then, of course, there is a converse side of it that somebody may make a false complaint just because he has something against his head of department, or he wants to take some revenge for something done to him. He may make a false complaint. So there is a penalty provided for that too. If the competent authority comes to a conclusion that this is malafidely done, deliberately done, and there is nothing in the complaint, there is a penalty provided. What is more heartening is that it covers all ministers, members of parliament, members of legislature, judicial officers, but not judicial officers, lower judiciary, including arbitrators, government officers, officers on public duty like election duty, officers of institutions receiving financial assistance from the government, including universities, cooperative banks, nationalized banks. All these are covered under this. And there is an appeal provided, but only against the penalty imposed, not for the action of the competent authority or any of the people, head of the department or anybody. So this is some of the positive aspects that it does try to protect the complainant to some extent, to a great extent. But there are a lot of drawbacks, which I'll come to. Now, some of the negative features in this bill. First, it says it doesn't. Here, it is not very clear. It starts by saying it does not apply to armed forces, but at the same time, there is a provision which says that as far as armed forces, police, and people are doing intellect, like in the RAW and those kind of bodies, their competent authority has not been announced yet to whom complaint can be made. That is all it is mentioned. It says under the Constitution, Article 33, these people are mentioned. That is the police, the armed forces, and those in the intelligence wing. For them also, you can make complaints, but they have to still notify to whom the complaint is to be made. So at present, they're not under the purview of this act, but they will be as soon as the competent authority is announced. Now, as far as the Prime Minister himself and the Chief Ministers, they do not fall under this because the complaint of their ministers under them goes to them. But there is nothing mentioned about what happens if there's a complaint against the Prime Minister himself or the Chief Ministers. Similarly, the judges of the High Court and Supreme Court have been left out of the purview of this. All the judicial officers of a lower rank, their complaint goes to the High Court. But these people themselves, there is no authority mentioned to whom you can make a complaint against them. Then it says that that no anonymous complaints are entertained. So you have to reveal your name, maybe only to the competent authority. But there are cases where, like I said, you worry that it will go from the competent authority's office, it will leak somewhere, and you would rather just give the complaint and the documents and not talk about, and not give your name. But that is not permitted under this act. You have to reveal your name, and the competent authority has to talk to you and say that, is this really your complaint, before he even starts working on it. So he has to identify you, see that you are the complainant, only then the complaint is looked into. This can have both good points and bad points. There are people who just make anonymous complaints against somebody and then hope that person gets into trouble. So this you cannot do. But at the same time, if you are afraid of that you will be victimized, this is a cause of making a person decide, forget it, I won't make a complaint. I'd rather be silent. Why take the risk? So that has not been fully addressed in this case, that the person's identity need not be revealed at all. Of course, there is one thing which has been done in this act. They have said that any person, including an activist or an NGO, can make a complaint. So this person who, if he's afraid, he could probably give the things to an NGO and say, please make the complaint on my behalf. So if the NGO is convinced that yes, there is something worth complaining, but he's afraid to reveal his identity, could take all the documents and make a complaint. So that is one way of addressing this point, that you have to give your name and address before you make a complaint. Now, also this competent authority which has been appointed seems to be a bit toothless. All they can do is they can go into the complaint, find out, first they have to find out whether there is something in it at all, whether it is worth looking into or it is just a frivolous complaint. If it's just a frivolous complaint, it is dropped. If it's a malafide complaint, a different penalty and all those procedure will start. But there could be a complaint which is genuine. They've got feedback from the department. They found out that yes, this something needs to be done about it. Now what does the competent authority do after that? He can only make a recommendation back to the same department saying this is what action should be taken. And they are supposed to do it within 3 months or whatever time the competent authority gives. But there is a provision that they can say, no, we don't agree with you. We don't agree with that with your recommendation. We don't think there's anything wrong. And that's the end of it. There's no complaint. There's no appeal provided against that. Nothing you can do. You have to just drop it. If the department against which the complaint has been made just decides that, no, I don't agree with the competent authority's finding. So that is something which I think is very wrong with the bill. That needs to be addressed sometime. Then there are a lot of issues which have been left out of the purview of the bill. Like they say certain matters which are prejudice, sovereignty, integrity. Now these are almost the same things which are mentioned even in the Right to Information Act. These things are, they say you cannot give information. But in under this bill, there are many more things which I've added. Like they say defamation or incitement to an offense, decency, morality, anything which affects public order, decency or morality, contempt of court, these were not things ever in any other act. This has been brought in here so that more and more things go out of the purview of the bill. Then penalties have been provided for 3 or 4 issues. One, if you victimize a person in spite of his, victimization is not permitted, you are supposed to be protected against victimization. The only good thing they have said is that it is the department who, or the person who is victimizing him, who has to prove that this is not victimization. So if you go and complain and say that this has happened to me, I've been victimized, their first defense of course is going to be, no, we haven't done anything and he's just complaining. But then it is for them to prove that this is not victimization, this was, he actually deserved this punishment or this transfer or something. You don't have to prove it. The complainant doesn't have to go and prove that yes, I've been, he has to only make a statement, go to the competent authority and say that this is what's being done, I'm being victimized. So that in a way is good, though victimization is not defined as what it is, but it is for the department to say that this is not victimization. We have only transferred him because maybe 3 years was over, he was due for a transfer, whatever it is. And similarly, there is a penalty for victimization, but it is not a criminal offense, it's just a fine. So there's a fine up to maximum 50,000 rupees, which may not be much for some government departments, but that is the only thing. There is no criminal offense attached to victimization. But as far as revealing the identity of a person is concerned, that is treated as a criminal offense. And you can go up, can be sent to prison for up to maximum of 3 years if you reveal the identity of the person. Because see, there are several stages. First, the competent authority gets the name. He is not supposed to tell the head of the department who the person is, except with the permission of the person. Then the head of the department calls people to give information. So there again, the person's name is not supposed to be revealed. But if it just leaks out and somebody is found to be guilty of that, then they can be punished up to imprisonment of 3 years or a fine. And similarly, if the person who has made the complaint has done it deliberately, malafidely, without any truth to the complaint, then he can be punished also with a punishment up to 2 years. But nothing has been provided as to what is malafide, what is treated as, maybe he prima facie really truly believed there was something, and then it turns out that it was not. The competent authority can drop it, but he can't punish him. So that has not been clearly explained either. Then once an action is proved, like I said, he can just recommend. There nothing is mentioned of what are the actions to be done if it is proved that a complaint was true. if somebody, if there is something wrong in that department, somebody has taken money, something is going gravely wrong, the competent authority can say, yes, some action should be taken. But he cannot monitor what is to be taken. So instead of, it's only a recommendation, it's not a direction saying you do this action. Suspend so and so, dismiss somebody else, or try to recover the money in such and such a way. All those things are not in, within the powers of the competent authority. It is for the same department against whom the complaint is made who has to decide what should be done. Which again feels like, how do you tell your own, suppose you tell the mother that yes, the child needs to be punished. It's going to be, unless she's, it's going to be some minor punishment. It's something like that. So they just don't... So these are the quite a few of the... Then there are some small mistakes in the Act, which, like one of them, it says that the competent authority can pass interim orders if he feels that a corruption is ongoing, it's going on. He can pass orders to stop it, to prevent the thing. The Act talks about he can pass orders to prevent the stoppage, which cannot, I'm sure it doesn't mean that. It means that he can stop the corruption when continuing. And similarly, the penalty sections also have some mistakes. But otherwise, a lot of strengthening needs to be done. And this alone is just doesn't seem to be sufficient. Now, if we, especially if we see the comparison between what is international laws and what is in our country, you would see very clearly that so many things which need to be covered have not been covered. Like in its current shape and form, India, our bill fares very poorly compared to international standards. And these are the different ways in which it fares poorly. The whistleblower and safe, the whistleblower should feel that it is safer, should not feel that it's safer to keep quiet. Let me not, okay, I've seen something, I'm not doing anything wrong, why should I reveal it? I'll get punished, I'll be victimized. So there should be a safe alternative. He should feel that, no, I'll be protected and I have nothing to worry about. Only then this bill is effective, and that is really not fully covered in our Act. Then public interest disclosure must include all bona fide warnings of various types of unlawful acts. Here, like I said, they have covered only corruption, financial corruption, and loss to the government. They have not covered human rights violations or any environmental violation or health, education. None of those things are covered. That public interest disclosure must include wrongdoings committed by ministers. That is covered, except the Prime Minister and the Chief Minister have been left out. Public interest disclosure must cover wrongdoing in the private sector. This is not covered at all. Though this was suggested that the private sector, the corporates must be included, because there is so much wrongdoing in among corporates also, like what happened in Satyam and all. But this has not been covered, so people there are still would still be worried about coming up with a complaint against their company. Whistleblowers in the public sector, including members of the armed forces, intelligence services, they're not covered at present. But if a competent authority is appointed for them, they would get covered. Issues in employment law relating to protection of the whistleblower against retaliatory action must be codified. Now this, like I said, they have not said what is victimization and how he should be protected. It's a general clause that he should be protected against victimization. Issues in criminal law and procedure for protecting the whistleblower and other witnesses against criminal prosecution for defamation or breach of official or business secrecy must be codified. This also is, I would say, not partially codified, not codified at all. Issues in relation to media law. Now, there was a suggestion that a whistleblower could give his documents, his information to the media. So if the media protects his name, he would be fine, but that's not covered under this Act and it's not permitted. Public and private sector bodies must be incentivized to establish internal mechanisms for whistleblowing, not covered, no mechanism in public authorities is prescribed. He has to complain directly to the competent authority. Like the competent authority, say for all central government, is the Central Vigilance Commission. for all state government offices, it is the State Vigilance Commission. Now, there are not many states have not set up a State Vigilance Commission. So they've said if it's not set up, any other authority that the act, they may notify. So that is also still to come. So you don't really have even competent authorities appointed for all officers. Whistleblower must be provided guidance and counseling. That's definitely not there. Disclosures of wrongdoing must be properly investigated. Information must reach the senior management promptly, not covered. Wrongdoing is inquired into by the competent authority with the head of the department providing comments. Whistleblower must be informed about the progress of an investigation. Now, it's only at the end, after the competent authority sends the recommendations and the department comes back and said, yes, we have done this or we are not going to do it, then the whistleblower is informed that this is what has happened. But what is happening in between, he is not kept informed. So he has no idea, he has no way of finding out whether the competent authority has done the work properly, whether the head of the department who has been told has given the documents. He has no way of monitoring anything. It is completely left to the competent authority to do what they feel is proper. And then, of course, if the head of the department does not give documents, the competent authority has the powers of a court and can call for witnesses, call for, to that extent it has been provided. Whistleblower's identity must not be disclosed without his consent in order to avoid serious, this is provided that it can't be thing. Whistleblower must have recourse to the enforcement mechanism to make a complaint against victimization, have it investigated, be able to claim interim relief. Oh, there is no clause whatsoever for interim relief or appropriate compensation. All it says is that he can complain to the competent authority and competent authority will protect him. We'll see that it will protect him in what way. He'll probably call the head of the department and say, no, you can't do this to him. But nothing, the competent authority doesn't have any more powers than that. Whistleblowing to external authorities, including the media, this is not provided in this act. He must be treated as having acted in good faith if he has reasonable grounds to believe that the information disclosed was true, even if it turns out later that the wrongdoing had not been occurred. This, of course, is not, there is no punishment for this. They only say they'll drop it. And after giving him a chance to once again explain why he has filed a complaint, it'll be dropped. There is, but if it is found malafide and it is again the competent authority who decides, there's no appeal against it. So if he feels it's malafide, he can enforce punishment. Law must create a risk for person who victimizes a whistleblower employee, though possible sanction including removal from office. This only talks about 50,000 fine. It doesn't talk about that person being punished in any other way. It says maximum of 50,000 fine. In a case of victimization of whistleblower, law must reverse the burden of proof. This has been done. Law must provide for consequences of accusation made in bad faith. That is covered. Law must be monitored and evaluated at regular by independent bodies. That we have to see how what will happen.